see each and every one of you. Please excuse my voice, it's fighting some nasal drainage, and so hopefully we can get through this morning. Okay, don't get your hopes up. I still will preach, but no. It's good to be in God's house this morning, but as we start today, I'm sure, hopefully there's not anybody here today that doesn't or hasn't heard of what happened, obviously, last night in Pennsylvania. And as we start this morning, I just want to open with a word of prayer, but not only praying for God's continued hand of protection on all of our leaders. I said this even in Sunday school this morning. Hopefully we would be just as concerned and burdened of any political leader or candidate that was running for office that something like this would happen to. And so we need to pray for God's hand upon our country and also lift up those families who, the one where someone was injured and then also someone who lost their life last night. And folks, this world is a wicked, wicked place, and sin is evident in every where we turn, every aspect of life. And may we be vigilant for asking God's hand of leading and protection, but also that we are living for Him and seeking to tell as many people as possible that we might be the instruments that lead people to the Lord before their lives come to an end. So let's begin and open in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, as we come before you this morning, Lord, we recognize that we'd be lost without you. Father, as our Creator, our all-powerful Lord and Master, Lord, we come into your presence this morning. Father, declaring our need for you. Father, for what incidents took place last night. God, we do thank you that you spared President Trump's life. Lord, we pray for your hand upon him. Father, we lift up the family that lost a loved one last night at this event. We think also of when someone else who was injured, Father, we pray your hand of healing upon them as well. But Lord, we as Americans, we as people, as a nation, we need you, Father. We need your healing hand upon our country. Well, we understand that each day we grow yet another day closer to the day in which you will call us home. Father, we know that sin has had and will continue to have a horrible, devastating effect on all, Father, on all of creation. Lord, it would be our desire that you would bring healing to our land, Lord. Father, that we as a country would come back to you. Lord, that we as your children here in this country, Father, would seek your face daily. Lord, praying for your hand upon our country. Father, that you would use us and work in the hearts of those who do not know you as Savior. Father, drawing them to you. Lord, it would be our desire to see this nation truly embrace and be that one nation under God. We can't do it without you. And we humbly ask for your hand of wisdom, your hand of strength, and your hand of protection upon us. And we ask all these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. As we get started this morning, will y'all join with me as we say our memory verse for the month of July? John 15:7. If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. John 15:7. Amen. Would y'all stand with me? And you can't sit for this song, but as I mentioned earlier, my voice is hopefully going to last through, but I really need you all this morning, and you have no problem with it, singing out and worshiping our great Lord together. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah.
Curriculum become more Christian. So that's another second thing. Another way is that we do camping ministries throughout the summer, English camps for, English is a very sought after language. So it's kind of like having VBS for a week, but you're learning English, but you're actually doing VBS. So that's been a highly successful ministry as well. So lots of, if anything could be kind of twisted into education, those are the kind of things that Teach Beyond is working with. So then I'm serving at Black Forest Academy, which is in Germany. Our goal is to provide a quality international Christian education that will equip our students to influence their world through biblical thought, character, and action. It's always exciting. Our kids are multilingual, multicultural. They will be movers and shakers in the world. And so providing them with the tools that they need that they can go on. And I'm a high school English teacher in that. So Black Forest Academy has a set of core values, and they are truth, transformation, influence, community, and global-mindedness. We seek truth so that it can transform us, so that we can influence those in whatever community God places us in, because we're all part of God's global community that we're all citizens of this global community. So it's exciting to work with students, and I love those core values because in the end, they're not just for students at Black Forest Academy, they're for all of us. Whether you are working in the automotive shop, whether you're working in education, whether you're a stay-at-home mom, no matter what you're doing, we have the chance to seek truth, allow it to transform us, so that we can influence everyone who comes within our sphere of our community. And the different communities that we weave in and out of, can we be God in those communities? So I'm actually going to be home for my home assignment year soon. So I'll come home and I'll do a better presentation, a bigger presentation then. This was kind of like a quick, I'm home for the summer. Things have kind of changed for me. I came home a month early, so I had to take a leave of absence for a month because I'm dealing with elder care. So my new responsibilities are trying to figure out what to do for my dad. So that's my main prayer request is I need clarity and wisdom about next steps for my father. Dealing with dementia, health issues, and so trying to figure out as someone who, my solution for all things is if I'm sick, you go to bed and you wake up in the morning, you feel better. So for the moms in here going, that's not how that works. So I don't have a lot of help, a lot of wisdom on how to care for. My father also is very belligerent towards me right now and does not want me around. And so I'm planning to leave August 9th to go back to Germany to serve out my last year on my contract. And then I have to come to Indiana for my year home assignment. Everything got kind of sped up because I was planning on doing all this stuff I'm doing now in my year home assignment. But he was released from the nursing home. Therefore, he's at home and we're dealing with. So like, I have 3 weeks before I go back. We kind of need some wisdom in those 3 weeks of what has to happen next. So if that could be prayer for me personally. I had a great school year last year. I was off a semester after my mother's funeral. I was here for a semester. Went back and did my second semester, so it was a blessing to be in the classroom last year. My spiritual gift is teaching. The thing that gives me joy in my life is teaching. And so to be back in the classroom last year for a full year was good, but I also made 11 transatlantic flights in the last 2 years. And so something has to happen where it gets settled down a little bit so that I don't have to keep coming back and forth every holiday or on emergency calls. And it's hard because there's a lot of people who are saying, like, we'll just stay here, but that's also not that easy of a decision as well. So we just need clarity on what needs to happen. And the other thing is a prayer request for BFA. So we're in the middle of a fundraising project that we would like you to pray for. It's called Project Immeasurably More. So we are a boarding school, and two of our dorms are in really bad shape. And so one of them, every day when the guys go to school, the dorm parents go through and they clean all the walls because there's mold. So like our guys come in, they have no allergy, they leave BFA and they have a mold allergy because our one dorm is in such bad shape. We're just praying right now that the health services don't come by and visit because we might get shut down. So we plan to build a new dorm. And so that's what we were looking at. We're like, okay, we can build a dorm. We'll put these one big building, two dorms. And in the middle of that, God dropped an amazing property into our lap that's already built. There's a nursing home that is, it's like walking from here to the school. That's how far away this property is from our buildings. It's a three-story building. It will house three dorms. And so it's really exciting that, you know, we limited God to two dorms. And God said, I can do better than that. And he gave us a measurement more than what we were looking for. So now we're raising money to pay for the new dorm. So we're looking for some large donors. So we have our advancement team is like doing their like advancement thing and reaching out to people. So if you could pray, we're hoping to be in the dorms by 2026. And so if you could pray for us that we could pay for them. We have to renovate them. They're going to be the safest dorm rooms ever because they have like all the, you know, if you fall in the bathroom, you can pull the little thing because it's a nursing home right now, so it's got really great safety features and stuff in it. But we really need these two dorms to keep going. And by adding the third dorm, it means we can service 20 more families, missionary families that are looking for education. So I'm going to be around afterwards. That was a short, very short presentation. Not a lot about what I specifically do. So I'm going to be around after the service if you'd love to ask questions about my ministry. I will warn that if you ask me too many questions about personal things, you need to be prepared that I may cry on you. So, ministry would be great questions, right? So, thank you.
Thank you, Joe. All right, I have a note to read. First of all, Good News Baptist Church, first of all, thank you to all the BBS kids for buying Bibles for our believers in Kenya. Hearing God's word is very important. He has a real blessing. It was a real blessing to be with you all for Sunday morning services. You guys here are a big encouragement to Michelle and me. May our God multiply his blessings to each of you, George and Michelle Wendell. And we appreciated them being here, and we appreciated the BBS offering that we were able to give them. So that's good to hear. All right, let's take our bulletins and look at what we have coming up. Tonight at 5 p.m. is a summer small group right here at Good News Baptist Church. We're doing that. We are combining them. You don't have to go anywhere else. But we're also doing it as a farewell to the Spencers. So please come, enjoy yourself, and it'll be a good time. Wednesday is a normal prayer meeting. We will not have men's Bible study this week because Pastor Joe and Mindy are going off on vacation. And we need to pray about that also so that they can have a good time and get rested up. It says they're returning fall. We are looking at doing the shoe boxes again. So think about that. Start buying stuff to fill them up. All right. Let's see. I think that's everything on that. On our prayer sheet, of course, we have a couple of new ones. We have word that Pastor Ed, our old pastor, has been diagnosed with prostate cancer. He went in and did the biopsy, and they're checking other places and such, and he was home for a day and woke up with a fever, and they put him back in the hospital. So just keep praying for that family also, if you would. All right, is that all that I can remember for now that I need to do? Do pay attention to the prayer sheet, please. Pray for those people. There's people that have been on there for a long time, still need prayers. You'll see the new ones added week by week, so pray for them. Prayer is a gift that God has given us that says we can talk directly to him. Do we need it? Yes, we do. Does he need it? Yes, he does, or else he wouldn't have allowed us to do it. He wants us to pray to him, even though he knows everything that's going to happen. Doesn't matter. He still wants to talk with us. He wants to hear what's happening. He wants to hear our request, and he's faithful in answering. So please do pray. Is there anything else or something I may have missed? Thank you.
I Thank you, Tom. Our scripture reading this morning is from Psalm 6. Psalm 6 this morning. Beginning in verse 1 there, it says, O Lord, do not rebuke me in your anger, nor chasten me in your wrath. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for I am pining away. Heal me, O Lord, for my bones are dismayed, and my soul is greatly dismayed. But you, O Lord, how long? Return, O Lord, rescue my soul. Save me because of your loving kindness. For there is no mention of you in death. In Sheol, who will give you thanks? I am weary with my sighing. Every night I make my bed swim. I dissolve my couch with my tears. My eye has wasted away with grief. It has become old because of all my adversaries. Depart from me, all you who do iniquity. For the Lord has heard the voice of my weeping. The Lord has heard my supplication. The Lord receives my prayer. All my enemies will be ashamed and greatly dismayed. They shall turn back. They will suddenly be ashamed. Would y'all stand with me as we continue worshiping the Lord together?
Thank you.
If you got your Bibles, would you go with me to Matthew chapter 10? Matthew chapter 10 is where we're at this morning. Is that on, James? Matthew chapter 10. Verses 32 and 33. Today is really we have our small group tonight, so we're continuing with our theme of discipleship and the things that mark and identify what it means to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Matthew 10, verse 32 says, "Therefore, everyone who confesses me before men, I will also confess it before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny him before my Father who is in heaven." Lord, as we come before you this morning, Father, I ask your hand upon us now. Father, may your words be spoken here today. May they be a challenge to each and every one of us. Father, may we have a desire to truly follow you. Lord, may our lives be marked as those who belong to you, those who confess and testify of you. Lord, we ask this in your precious and your most holy name. Amen. I recently read about some of the beginnings of church ministry in the country of Uganda. In the story I was reading, there were three young boys, all brothers. The oldest was 15 and the youngest was 11. And their desire to stand for Christ was the very opportunity that the king of Uganda saw as an example in which he could stamp out the church and stamp out Christianity in the kingdom of Uganda. As they were arrested for their refusal to not stop proclaiming Jesus Christ and standing for him, their parents, along with many others, pleaded with the boys to stand down. But here's what they said on the day of their execution. The oldest said, "Please tell His Majesty that He has put our bodies in the fire, but we won't be long in the fire. Soon we shall be with Jesus, which is much better. But ask Him to repent and change His mind, or He will land in a place of eternal fire and desolation." It got me thinking, man, at 15 years old, how many of us have the same kind of integrity and commitment to Jesus Christ? Here, a 15-year-old boy and his two younger brothers, the youngest boy, who was only 11, said, "Please, don't come off my arms. I promise I will not struggle in the fire that takes me to Jesus." And Lord, give us strength to have that kind of integrity and zeal for the one we claim we owe everything to. Surely, we don't have to wait for persecution to come knock on our door for us to be tested. Surely, we can take that stand even now, joyfully sharing the gospel. You know, as a result of those boys' testimony, 40 people came to Christ that day. Now, I completely understand that our circumstances are not the same, but I would ask you, can you honestly say, "I want my life to have that kind of impact for the name of Jesus Christ"? I'm very thankful that we have our dear sister Jill here today. I'm thankful for the impact that she gets to have on the lives of missionary kids who hopefully the Lord is going to take, you know, she, for them as the movers and shakers. It's incredible to think that some of those kids coming out of that ministry are then going to go out and continue spreading the wonderful news of Jesus Christ, no matter where the Lord may take them. Do we strive to have an impact? You know, if we want our lives to impact the cause of Jesus Christ and the gospel, if you would say yes, then have you stopped to ever ask God, what would you have me do? See, we've talked about this several times. In the structure of the church, the church is often portrayed by Paul as a body. Each part of us performs a different function so that the body continues to accomplish its purpose. But we don't go to the Lord and say, well, here, Lord, I'm only going to serve you as a hand, or I'm only going to serve you as a foot, or I'm only going to serve you as a mouth. No. We're to come unto him and say, Lord, what is it that you are calling me to do? It's not about what I get to accomplish or what is going to be produced as a result. It's, Lord, I want to know that I'm doing what you've called me to do. And regardless of whether my life gets used to lead just a small handful to you and point them to Christ, or you use me to lead thousands, I just want to have that impact for you. We can get distracted by so many things, but hopefully our heart says, I want to have an impact. And it starts by following him, striving to truly be a disciple. I hope that is what you and I are seeking. Not just to follow Christ, but to be known. We ought to desire to have those reputations that say, that's someone who loves the Lord. That's someone who follows the Lord. You know, so far in our discipleship series, we've been going through Matthew chapter 10. And first and foremost, being a disciple means that we are following Jesus Christ to the extreme of striving to be like him in word and deed, to truly be students, not just casual followers, but dedicated students of Jesus Christ and his word. It means that we count the cost. We learn his actions and we follow them actively, daily. Now last month, we moved into verses 26 through 31. And I want to read those verses again just to help kind of tie in with the flow of today's text. Starting verse 26, Matthew says, or Jesus said there in Matthew, therefore do not fear them, for there is nothing concealed that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. What I tell you in the darkness, speak in the light, and what you hear whispered in your ear, proclaim upon the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body, but are unable to kill the soul. Rather, fear him who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a cent? And yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. But the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So do not fear. You are more valuable than many sparrows. Last month we talked about the first thing that Jesus teaches us there that ought to mark us or be an identifying aspect of us as disciples is that we do not fear. A true disciple is marked by that lack of fear. Now I say a lack of fear because there is good fear and bad fear. Fearing the Lord is the right kind of fear. And I have several verses I want to read through quickly, but man, when I was looking this up, there are hundreds of verses that talk about fearing God or not fearing or the fear of the Lord. And there's so many different perspectives that are just incredible, and I've just picked a few, but listen to what the Bible says about fearing the Lord. In Proverbs 1:7, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. It's the beginning of knowledge. You know, one thing, whenever I come to a study in the book of Proverbs, there's one important question you have to ask almost in any verse you read out of Proverbs. Do I want to be wise or do I want to be a fool? And you consider what he says there. Fools despise wisdom and instruction, but the fear of the Lord, wisdom is found in fear. It's the beginning of knowledge. Proverbs 8:13, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil. Pride and arrogance and the evil way and the perverted mouth, I hate. See, I've shared many times, and there's some different definitions, and there's several good ones out there, but the fear of the Lord, one of the best ways I've found to really describe it is having a right perspective of who God is. One of my favorite authors, Jerry Bridges, describes fearing the Lord as reverential awe, to be in awe of who he is. Yes, there is a degree of fear. Why? Because he's my heavenly Father. I don't know about y'all, but I had a good, healthy fear of my dad growing up. Why? Because if I got in trouble, I knew I was going to get whooped for it. And I had that healthy fear of my Father. Do we have that right perspective that as God's children, when we sin, there are consequences to our sin? Now, granted, the one that ought to mean the most to us is when I choose to sin as a believer. I am forfeiting fellowship with God until I come back to Him and confess it. He never fails me. I'm the one who fails Him. But as much as the fear of the Lord is having a right perspective of who God is, it's also having the perspective that God has on things. And I don't think there's anyone who would argue with me here. God hates sin. He hates evil and wickedness. We are to hate it too. Going on to Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 13. The conclusion, or the sum of it all, as the writer says, when all has been heard, it's this. Fear God. Keep His commandments. Because this applies to every person. Psalm 33. Let all the earth, not just believers, let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of Him. As we prayed this morning, it's evident with what happened yesterday that we still live in a wicked, sin-filled, and sin-cursed world. And what does this world need? What do we need as a nation? We need Jesus Christ, amen? I think I've shared this many times, but I would love to think that God would allow one more great revival to happen in our country before He comes back and raptures the church. I would love to think that when Christ raptures the church, there are so many Americans that have come to Christ, received His wonderful gift of salvation, that there's really just literally not too many people left in this country. I'd rather it be that way than the potential that once God removes believers from this world, when He raptures His church, then it just then becomes a free fall into wickedness. And to think that's even worse than maybe the way and the conditions of our world right now, what a scary thought. If all the inhabitants of the world would just stand in awe of Him and recognize who He is. Unfortunately, the Bible tells us there, and Jesus told us in Matthew, that wide is the gate that leads to destruction. The majority of people, even if they hear the message, will reject it. These and many more verses point to what fearing God should be. But there's also some verses in Scripture that talk about the blessing that the fear of the Lord is. In Luke 1, chapter 1, verse 50, it says, and His mercy is upon generation after generation toward those who fear Him. What is mercy? Mercy is God withholding the judgment we rightly deserve. Now, I was talking about this morning in our Sunday school, and I love the concept and the aspect of God's grace. But you can't talk about His grace without talking about His mercy. And as much as I need His grace in my life every day, you and I both, we also need His mercy. Because we deserve not only to die and go to hell, but we don't deserve one day of life. Every day is a gift, and what do we do with that gift that comes from God? And yet, what does Scripture say? His mercy is upon generation after generation toward those who fear Him. It's a blessing. Going on to, coming back even to Proverbs 14, verse 27. The fear of the Lord is what? A fountain of life. You know, sometimes in hearing some of the things that people use to describe Christianity believers and even would go as far to call us as religious nutcases. Oh, you just want to impose all your rules. Those who see that kind of Christianity, they don't understand what it means. The fear of the Lord is not this I'm cowering in fear. It's a fountain of life. Something that is refreshing, that one may avoid the snares of death. But you know what? The purpose, you know, one of the blessings of salvation is not just eternal life. God actually wants us to have joy in this life as we live for Him and serve Him. That's part of fearing the Lord. Coming to Psalm 25. The secret of the Lord is for those who fear Him, and He will make them know His covenant. I was looking into this because some other translations that say, you know, the one who fears the Lord is a friend of the Lord. And so I started looking into it. And this word for secret, it's the kind of thing that you would only share with someone who is very, very close to you. Almighty God in heaven
who made it possible even back in the Old Testament because of sacrifices that were made so that he could dwell among the people, would one day then turn the table when Jesus Christ, the perfect sacrifice, would come. He would not only provide salvation for us, he'd not only provide God's presence when we get saved, now we receive the Holy Spirit when we get saved, but what he accomplished makes it possible not for just God to dwell with us, but that one day we get to go dwell with him. How amazing. And to think that that same God, who is perfect and holy and cannot abide in the presence of sin, not only wants that closeness and dwelling with us, he wants that intimate friendship with us. The secret of the Lord is for those who fear him, and he will make them know his covenant. One more, Psalm 86:11. Teach me your way, O Lord. I will walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. Now, if I were to come and maybe I was trying to whisper, you know, some sweet words to my wife, I was like, you know, I want to walk with you. I want to spend that time with you. So, Mindy, will you teach me how to fear you? Sounds kind of funny when you put it like that. But that's understanding that the fear of the Lord is not this, I'm cowering or afraid. It's I see who you are. And I want to walk with you. I want my heart united with you. I want to have that close connection to you, Father. The fear of the Lord is truly an incredible blessing. As I said, I can probably list at least 100 different verses all pointing to the fear of the Lord. But I want us to ingrain in our minds what the fear of the Lord is and why we should seek it. But to truly fear God means we cannot fear man. So a true disciple will not fear man or persecution. We know God is just, yet loving, and a healthy fear of him comes with a realization of just how valuable we are to him. As verse 31 ends, aren't you more valuable than a whole bunch of little sparrows? Of course you are. With that kind of confidence and gratitude, how could we possibly ever contain such a love and joy? When we come into verses 32 and 33 today, the second thing that should mark us as true disciples of Christ is that we are those who confess Jesus Christ. We confess him as Lord. Along the lines of our last two messages in Acts, we are in a place of decision that we must act upon daily. Will we confess or will we deny Jesus Christ? Not through the rest of our life. What decision will we make today? And it's a daily decision we have to make. Will I confess Jesus Christ today, or will I deny him today? And you might say, well, Pastor, it seems kind of obvious. Maybe we don't want to deny Jesus Christ. How are we confessing? Starting in verse 32, it's these two decisions, the two points, if you would, for today's message. Those who confess and those who deny him. Okay. Verse 32 says, therefore, everyone who confesses me before men, I will also confess him before my Father who is in heaven. What is our reason to confess Christ? You know, a typical response might be, you know, we want to lead people to Jesus Christ. We want to see people get saved. And that should absolutely be our goal. But folks, we must never lose sight of our personal responsibility. What is your reason? You know, what is, you know, your reason, Bethany? What is your reason, Bill? What is your reason, Troy? What is your reason, Tom? I mean, asking that question, each of us asking, Lord, here's why I want to confess you today. Here's what you mean to me in my life. What would you say to them? What is your reason for casting aside fear and going and talking to your neighbor? Or talking to your coworker, or talking to another student about the Lord. I hope that it's a result of a love for Jesus Christ and a burden for those lost people around you. And I hope those are the things that we allow to override fear or the hesitation that we might have to confess Jesus Christ. Remember, a disciple doesn't fear man or the world. We are to be bold, my brothers and sisters. We are to tell people who Jesus is. As for confession, what does Jesus mean when he instructs us to confess? See, confess is not just an acknowledgement or a statement. It is a wholehearted affirmation that cannot be swayed. Now, to put this maybe in a very easy, understandable, I maybe say this with a bit of a heavy heart. I was talking with somebody yesterday, I think it was on Friday, and something got up, brought up about sports, and I'm just like, I don't want to talk about it right now. None of my Chicago sports teams are looking very, very good. But I'll tell you this, and I say this jokingly, I'm a Cubs fan. I believe that shows real faith, because Hebrews 11:1 says, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. I don't know if I'll get to see another World Series championship in my life, but as much as I joke with that with levity, while there's nobody who could ever convince me or make me stop cheering for one of my Chicago teams, I'm sorry, Chelsea, but nothing will ever happen where I will ever root for the Packers. It just won't happen. But as much as I can joke and have that much affirmation about a stinking sport, how much more should my affirmation of who my Savior is be? There should be that over-exuberance that Jesus Christ is my Lord. He's my King. I love Him. I can't help but tell people about Him. And there's nothing you can do that will ever convince me that He's not King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That He didn't accomplish my salvation once for all, as Hebrews says. What is your confession of Jesus Christ? What would people say about how much you are dedicated to Him? As evidenced by how you live, by the things that you say. We have an incredible affirmation that should never be able to be swayed. In good times and bad, we will choose to praise the Lord. We will tell of His excellent greatness. That is who Jesus is, amen? Interestingly enough, that phrase in that verse there, before men, is another indication of fearless faith. There is no one we should be unwilling to tell, and there's no place we should be unwilling to speak. Not all opportunities will be in public places, but there cannot be an unwillingness to proclaim, even in the crowded places. What if God wants you to witness and confess to a specific person, but without your realization, He's actually causing other people who are standing around listening to hear as well? I've said many times, we're not to focus on the results. If we're truly seeking to follow and obey, that's what Jesus Christ wants from us, obedience. But here's an example of Jesus revealing the result of those who confess Him before men. He will confess those individuals before the Father. That's what He says. In other words, Jesus will intentionally point out those who loyally and faithfully confess Him. Father, these are the ones. They're the ones who are faithfully obeying and telling mankind about us. Ooh, what a privilege. To think that Jesus is going to speak to the Father and say, look how they're obeying. Isn't it wonderful? Isn't it incredible? They really do love us. They're demonstrating it because they will not stop confessing us before men. I wish I could stop there on a positive thought. But there is a cautionary warning about those who deny. In verse 33, whoever denies me before men, I will also deny Him before my Father who is in heaven. I hope all of us here today would never, ever openly defy or reject Jesus Christ. But folks, if you think that a public denial of Christ is all that you have to avoid, it may hurt you to find out that we have all been guilty of denying Jesus Christ. Maybe not by our words, maybe even more so by our lack of words and speaking up when we should. There's no such thing as a secret Christian. You know, you consider the phrase, hiding your faith. Well, that's an oxymoron. It's an insane contradiction. Your faith is the thing that you not only claim to believe, but it's the essence of how you choose to live your life. How can you hide who you are? You know, there may be a host of things that we either don't know or remember about each other, but hopefully Those are the smaller, trivial things that do not define who we are. What do other people define you by? Your words and your actions should always point to Jesus Christ. We are to confess Him with our lives. If confessing Him is something you desire to do, I did something this week. I went out and I gathered a bunch of our spare tracts. We have some simple tracts. It's called God's Simple Plan of Salvation. I know some of you already do this faithfully. You carry tracts on you, you pass them out when you've got the opportunity. But if you would say to me, okay, Pastor, maybe I need to work better. I need to do a better job of confessing to Christ. Because the denial that he's talking about here, whoever denies me before men, I will also deny him before my Father who is in heaven. We can't lose our salvation, amen? Praise the Lord, we can't, because none of us are able to keep it. What he's talking about is that permanent rejection. That doesn't mean that I believe every one of us, if we're going to be honest, we've all had moments when we failed to confess Jesus Christ. And so if we fail to confess him, we have denied him by not speaking. God's not condemning us before the Father when we've had those failures. What he's saying, you may have failed to confess me, but start. Aren't you glad that he's a forgiving, merciful Father and Savior? He doesn't just abandon us the first moment we fail. Now, I hope, and I'm not going to make you raise your hand right now and say, okay, how many of you? I'm not going to guilt pressure you because I want you to be honest. But if you honestly would say, Lord, I want to be better. I want to be more faithful at confessing you. Right there, back there on that blue table, is a basket. I gathered up as many of our God's Simple Plan of Salvation tracts as I could find. You really want to confess Jesus Christ and be faithful in doing it, then I dare you, I challenge you, before you walk out of this room today, you grab five of those and you pass them out today, this week. Before you come back next Sunday, pass out five. That's not asking much, really. And you know what? Please don't do the simple, well, okay, and I'm not condemning leaving a track with your tip at a restaurant. I think, you know, those who do, I think it's a good thing, but don't just try to sneak it in and think, oh, well, hey, I left a track, so God, you do the rest. Now, if you're going to leave a track, then make sure you let your waiter or your waitress know what that is. Tell them. I got something I want you to read. And if they'll give you the opportunity to explain what it is, start reading it to them. Share with them what the plan of salvation is. Five tracks. We, hopefully, undoubtedly want to be known as those who confess Jesus Christ with our life. Here's an opportunity. What will you do? We all say we want to be God's disciples. We want to be truly identified as Jesus Christ. Let's put those words into action and go out this week and confess it. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed. Father in heaven, as we come before you now, Lord, we love you. I don't know what we would do without you, Lord. Not just for our salvation, but Father, we need you each and every day. And even in our need, Father, we recognize who you are. And we want to show you we love you. And we know that your word tells us that we demonstrate, we prove that love as we walk in obedience to you and to your word. Father, use us. Use us today. We ask these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Y'all stand with me as we sing a simple closing hymn. Thank you.
y'all and gives you a wonderful week. Don't forget, Miss Jill will be here, so if you've got a chance to go up and chat with her, I know she would love to answer any questions you have about her ministry and how the Lord's using her over there in Germany. And we do want to continue to keep her in our prayers, both for her ministry, but also keep her and her dad in our prayers. So let's close. Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you for the great privilege we've had to be here in your house today. Father, I pray that you would continue to mold and fashion us more and more into the image of Jesus Christ. And as you're doing so, Father, may we boldly go out and tell the world about you. Again, we ask your hand of protection and healing upon our country right now. Lord, we've got the answer. We've got the cure. May we boldly confess it. Lord, please be with Miss Jill. Thank you for her being able to be with us today. Lord, we ask your hand upon her ministry. Lord, also with everything concerning her dad. We ask this all in Jesus' precious name. Thank you. God bless y'all. Hope you have a wonderful week.